बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। आई वेलकम यू द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ फोर्थ ईयर MBBS टुडे इन सफदर सेठ ट्रस्ट हॉस्पिटल। टुडे आई विल बी डिलीवरिंग द लेक्चर ऑन कोएगुलेशन डिसऑर्डर्स एंड हेपरिन्स। लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ टुडेज लेक्चर्स आर दैट एट द एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर यू विल बी एबल टू नो डेफिनेशन ऑफ DIC, इट्स क्लिनिकल प्रेजेंटेशन, इट्स कॉम्प्लिकेशन एंड मैनेजमेंट, and then the mechanism of action of heparins, side effects of heparins, and antagonists of the heparins, and role of heparins in the DIC and thrombotic states. DIC is characterized by systemic activation of the blood coagulation, resulting in generation and deposition of the fibrin, leading to microvascular thrombi in various organs, contributing to the multiple organic dysfunction known as MODS. Now two mechanisms continue simultaneously. First one is that the derangement of the fibrinolytic system, I mean the fibrinolysis does not goes at its pace, and therefore the clot formation is the result. Or the other one is there is accelerated fibrinolysis. So fibrin degradation and fibrin formation, they go simultaneously. And when there is fibrinolysis, there is severe bleeding, and when there is failure of the fibrinolysis, there is clot formation. Hence thrombotic and bleeding phenomena, they go hand in hand with each other. So finally, it is an acquired syndrome with intravascular activation of the coagulation, loss of localization arising from the multiple etiologies. There is the origin of this mechanism is from and damage to the microvasculature, which results in the organic dysfunction. So basically the microvasculature, I mean the capillaries in combination with the platelets and the clotting cascade, they result in the genesis of the whole of this mechanism known as DIC. There are various causes of the DIC, and they are, it is not itself a specific illness, it is because of the various variable causes of different types, which includes the activation of the system, sepsis and severe infection, and the severity correlates with the mortality. The gram positive organism may be responsible, or the gram negative organism may be responsible. Similarly, viruses, fungi and parasites may also be implicated in the systemic inflammation of the DIC. It may also accrue because of the trauma, neurotrauma and systemic inflammatory response known as SIRS, and in which the cytokines have a definitive major role in the creation of the systemic inflammatory response. Ultimately, the organs are destroyed. The other causes of the DIC may be malignancies, and sometimes severe transfusion reactions can lead to the DIC. Obstetric complications include amniotic fluid embolism, abruptio placentae, hemolysis, in which there is elevated liver enzymes, low platelets, and there is eclampsia. Now the combination of hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes and low platelets is known as HELLP syndrome, and it is an obstetric state. Sometimes the retained dead fetus leads to the DIC. Then vascular abnormalities like Kassaberg-Merritt syndrome, in which there are aneurysms and thrombosis. Now the combo of hemangiomas and thrombocytopenia is the hallmark feature of the Kassaberg-Merritt syndrome, which leads on to the DIC. Now severe hepatic failure is one of the commonest causes, and sometimes the envenomations, transfusion reactions late, especially the late one, can lead on to the and similarly to DIC, and the transplant rejections at late stages can convert into DIC or can cause the DIC. Severe toxic reactions similarly are one of the common causes of the DIC or disseminated intravascular coagulation. Heat stroke and hyperthermia are lesser common causes, but they are the causes. Similarly, hemorrhagic skin necrosis may be because of the severe drug reactions which can lead transform into the DIC or disseminated intravascular coagulation. Then finally, the catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome is also a known recognized cause or etiology of the disseminated intravascular coagulation. Now there are two types, acute DIC and chronic DIC. In acute DIC, there is sudden exposure of the blood to the procoagulants, and the procoagulant is tissue factor, which is actually the tissue thromboplastin, which results in the formation of the clots or intravascular coagulation. The compensatory hemostasis is overwhelmed. I mean, the antagonism to the coagulation is defeated, and therefore the coagulation goes on, advances on, and there is predominantly or preponderantly at this stage of the disease overwhelming coagulation. Now as a result, there is consumptive coagulopathy, which leads ultimately into the CF severe hemorrhage. So more is the coagulation, more is the end product of consumptive coagulopathy. And when there is consumptive coagulopathy, in which the platelets are also used, and clotting factors like fibrinogen, they are consumed, and therefore the clot failure results, and the patient transform into the hemorrhagic variety of the DIC. Now the coagulation parameters are identified, and ultimately the patient goes on to the organ failure. In chronic DIC, blood is continuously, intermittently exposed to the tissue factors known as tissue thromboplastins, and the compensatory mechanisms in the liver, bone marrow, they are not overwhelmed. Little clinical or lab findings of the DIC will, at this stage of the disease, will be recognizable. Especially, these are the chronic DIC is a feature of the solid tumors, large aortic aneurysms, and some symptoms are related to the underlying disease. And it may be because of the blood loss. It may result into the blood loss from the gingival, GIT. I mean, these are the presentation of the chronic DIC. The blood losses from the gingival, GIT. And similarly, patient may present to you with the petechiae, ecchymosis, and the bleeding from the IV lines or ecchymosis as a result of the IV line punctures, and similarly the puncture from the catheter sites and surgical sites, and the bleeding may go into the cavities. Now the you see the percentage of the features of the chronic DIC. Bleeding occurs in 64% of the cases, renal dysfunction has a score of 25%, and hepatic dysfunction is found in 19% of the cases, and respiratory system is involved in 16% of the cases, and shock can happen in 14% of the patients, and the CNS is involved in about 2% of the people. Now thrombosis or DVT, it may also be because of the musculovascular thrombosis, and in which the renal failure can occur about 25% of the cases of the DIC of the chronic variety. And there is also bleeding from at least three unrelated sites suggestive of the DIC. The patient may have dyspnea, patient may have hemoptysis, patient may have unexplained cough. Then comorbid liver disease plus hemolysis and jaundice can also be found in patients of the chronic DIC. The patient may also be found in obtunded state of conscious level, and the patient may also have feelings of paresthesias. The hemorrhagic variety with excess plasmin formation. You know, plasmin is an enemy of the prothrombin, which inhibits the prothrombin, and thrombin cannot act on the fibrinogen to convert into fibrin. So in the hemorrhagic variety, the plasmin formation is the main weapon. There, the presentation will be petechiae on the soft palate, trunk, limbs, and the patient may also have thrombocytopenia. Similarly, the patient will also be found to be having ecchymosis, especially at the venipuncture sites. And in the thrombotic variety, the circulatory failure will be resulting, and the signs of spontaneous and life-threatening hemorrhage can also occur, preceded by the thrombosis because of the consumptive coagulopathy. Now, the signs of the subacute bleeding and may also be found, and the signs of the diffuse or localized thrombosis may also be found, and finally the blood into the serous cavities like peritoneum, like pleural spaces, and like pericardial spaces, the blood may also be formed. These are the physical signs of the hemorrhagic variety of the, ranging from the bleeding into the cavities, from the sites of the venipunctures, and that is all because of the more plasmin formation in the hemorrhagic variety of the DIC, or disseminated intravascular coagulation. The CNS signs include, they are non-specific. The patient's altered sensorium or stupor may be unexplained. The history will not be suggestive sometime of the to determine the cause of the CNS symptoms or altered sensorium. Similarly, the patient may have transient focal neurological deficits and which recover, so cheating the treating physician to diagnose the case as DIC. Now, the CVS signs may be the patient is found to be in a hypotensive state, and the patient may also have tachycardia, and circulatory collapse or shock-like state may also be picked by the physician. And similarly, in the respiratory system, the patient may have pleural friction rub, or sometimes the signs of adult respiratory distress syndrome. This is a leaky lung syndrome in which the infiltrate goes on into the alveoli, and this leakage results into the thrombi, microthrombi, or fibrin deposition in the alveolar spaces. These are non-removable by the drugs. This is also found in corona patients. Now it is very common in our country or worldwide pandemic. It is a ARDS pneumonia. The COVID pneumonia mimics the ARDS, especially the severe variety of the corona infection or corona pneumonia. You can label it as a ARDS or adult respiratory distress syndrome. Now, the GIT signs, the patient can present with hematemesis, also with the hematochezia, in which there is only bleeding, plain bleeding per rectum. And the genitourinary system, the patient can present with the azotemia or the florid renal failure. The patient may also have acidosis, and the patient may complain of hematuria and oliguria because of the renal failure or azotemia. Similarly, the patient in the female can present with the metrorrhagia. Dermatological signs of the DIC, already discussed a little bit. Now, the petechiae, patient may also have jaundice, and patient may also have purpura, hemorrhagic bully, acral cyanosis, skin necrosis of the lower limbs, known as purpura fulminans. So, ranging from the petechiae to the purpura fulminans, hemorrhagic bully, and the purpura and acral cyanosis, these are the dominant dermatological signs of the DIC. Sometimes the infarctions and gangrenes can also be found in the advanced or severe form of the DIC. then ultimately there is wound bleeding and subcutaneous hematomas simultaneously coexist in the same patient of the DIC. Differential diagnosis includes dysfibrinogenemia, in which the fibrin is dysfunctional, it does not functioning properly, therefore it will fail to form the clot formation. Similarly, the hemolytic uremic syndrome is also an important differential of the DIC, and the name is indicative that there is hemolysis as well as the renal dysfunction. Sometimes the heparin-induced thrombocytopenia can present as both as thrombocytopenia, and at the end it can transform into the thrombosis, so it also is a strong contender of the DIC. ITP, immune thrombocytopenia, already discussed with you that the patient can, because of the thrombocytopenia in the severe cases, can present to you with the bleeding, and bleeding can mimic the DIC. Similarly, the TTP or thrombotic thrombocytopenia, in which there is this thrombocytopenia accompanied by thrombosis. So, in this aspect or respect, it is a contender of the DIC. Laboratory studies, you get done the PT, APTT, INR, sometimes they are high, and not PT is commonly they are high, and PT is found to be normal. APTT may be found to be high because of the activation of the thrombin or factor 10A, or as a result there is thrombin formation. The patient on CBC, you will be finding thrombocytopenia, and the high soluble fibrin levels may be elevated, fibrinogen levels are decreased. At the later stages, the FDPs or fibrin degradation products, they are found to be very high because of the fibrinolysis, and that is because of the plasmin, which breaks down the fibrin to the fibrin clot, and fibrin degradation products are found numerously in the DIC state, and this is one of the an important diagnostic tool of the DIC. Otherwise known as high D-dimer levels, these are the proof of the high thrombin. And the FDPs are higher, and again it is because of the thrombin. The underlying factor is the plasmin causing fibrinolysis. Fibrin is cross-linked by the thrombin activated factor 13A, and the cross-linked fibrin is formed, which is proteolyzed by the plasmin. So this is the whole mechanism. I mean, the clot formation mechanism is attacked by the plasmin, and as a result the D-dimers and the FDPs are produced, which are very important tests of the DIC. They are raised in the DIC states. Now, in the peripheral sphere, you may find schistocytes in chronic variety of the DIC, and the antithrombin level may also be got done. Similarly, the D-dimer level assay is also carried out, enzyme-linked immunoabsorbent assay, which will be high in this state. Then activation markers, zymogen is converted into prothrombin activation fragment, and F1 and F2 varieties are high in the DIC states. So these are the activation marker, zymogen. Then thrombomodulin is also high. It is a marker for the endothelial cell damage and multi-organ dysfunctions. Factor 8, factor 5 and factor 7 levels, they are consumed, and their consumption leads to the depletion, and therefore the levels of the factor 5 and the factor 7 will be found to be low. The patient similarly will be having deficiency of the vitamin K in DIC, the protein C and an antithrombin nature, which are natural anticoagulants, they will also be found below. Now you see, in protein C and protein S deficiency stage, there is preponderantly the DVT formation. I mean, it is a type in which, it is a type of the DIC in which the patient will be presenting to you initially with the thrombus formation. So it is a biphasic waveform abnormality of the APTT can be found. Sometimes it may be normal, but most of the time it is abnormally high. Now the treatment. Treat the underlying cause, which may be infection, which may be an obstetric complication or catastrophe in the bleeding variety. Platelet and coagulation factors are offered to the patient, and the specific deficiency of the fibrinogen, cryoprecipitate or FFP are given in the bleeding variety. In consumption induced deficiency of the coagulation factors, the FFPs and cryoprecipitates are offered to the patient. Similarly, vitamin K should also be given to the patients who present to you predominantly with the bleeding type of the DIC. Anticoagulants. Heparin inhibits coagulation through thrombin, and it inhibits the factor 2A. I mean, thrombin is a factor 2 which is inhibited by the heparin. The therapeutic dose of heparin in thromboembolic disease or in fibrin deposition, purpura fulminans or acral ischemia. Heparin in chronic DIC preponderantly or predominantly is given in the coagulant variety without consumpting coagulopathy. Mind it, remember this word, that whenever there is coexistent consumptive coagulopathy, then offering of the heparin can be more catastrophic or dangerous, lethal. Patient can die with the bleeding. So in the, you have to take care of whether the patient is in the state of consumption or not, because at that stage there will be no benefit, rather it will be disastrous if you offer the heparin to the patient. The low molecular weight heparin can be offered in decreased bleeding. It has caused decreased bleeding tendency and decreased organ failure, and can be offered as a prophylaxis, given as a subcutaneous, and it prevents thromboembolism. I mean, it can be offered, low molecular weight heparin can be offered in the thrombotic variety of the DIC. Antithrombin, which is inhibitor of coagulation, it is low in DIC but not successful so far. The tissue factor pathway inhibitor or TFPI inhibits coagulation, but there is no mortality benefit as experienced by multiple studies. The other drug which you can offer is recombinant thrombomodulin, especially in the septic variety and malignancy DIC states. It binds thrombin and protein C, and which is converted into activated protein C. It also, the results are not very good, but it is offered in patients who are suffering from DIC because of the sepsis and malignancy states. Recombinant factor 7A can also be given in bleeding variety of the DIC. Antifibrinolytic agents, aminocaproic acid or tranexamic acid in the bleeding variety of the DIC along with heparin can be given. So the intention is restoration of the anticoagulation pathways. For that matter, I have discussed all the things एंटीथ्रोम्बिन, टिश्यू फैक्टर, रिकम्बिनेंट थ्रोम्बोमोडुलिन, रिकम्बिनेंट फैक्टर 7A, ब्लीडिंग डीआईसी एंड एंटी फाइब्रिनोलिटिक एजेंट्स. नाउ दीज आर द साइंस. यू सी देयर इज गैंग्रीन ऑफ द फुट एंड टोज. दिस इज जनरलाइज हेमरेजिक वराइटी ऑफ द डीआईसी. नाउ दिस इज द स्किन नेक्रोसिस एंड स्किन अल्सरेशन because in found in patients of disseminated intravascular coagulation due to acetaminophen toxicity. Now you can see the paracetamol is commonly not expected to be produced this sort of state, but please keep in mind that every drug is a poison, so paracetamol can produce this sort of skin ulceration and necrosis, and the underlying mechanism is DIC. Vasculotoxic snake bite presenting with sepsis and acute fenotic failure. Now you see this patient is having ecchymosis, bleeding into the skin, and also the patient is also, so the breeder snakes, they can produce bleeding into the skin, into the eyes. The patient can present to you with the subconductival hemorrhages and renal failure. Now this is the pulpora firminans, and you know there is characterized by onset of widespread purpuric lesion that progress into the gangrenous necrosis of the pinna of the ear. This is pulpora firminans. The antithrombin 3 is a protein made in the liver. It inhibits coagulation and it limits the formation of the blood clots. It is because of the complete lack of the plasma protein C activity, which so deficiency of the protein C can presents with the purpura fulminans. Thank you very much. The theme behind is, the metaphor or theme is that the DIC is like a state, as if out of the frying pan into the fire. The coagulation is a frying pan, and if the patient attempts to save his life from the coagulation, but when he jumps out of the frying pan, he goes into the fire. That is the hemorrhagic variety of the DIC. Next topic is heparin. Now you know the heparin chemistry. Low molecular weight heparin, fractions of the heparin have a high affinity for activated factor 10A, whereas the unfractionated heparin, glycosaminoglycan, they bind antithrombin T, increasing its ability to inhibit thrombin factor 2A and 10A. So unfractionated heparin inhibit factor 10A and factor 2A, whereas the low molecular weight heparin inhibits the factor 10A only. Now inhibition of the thrombin and factor 10A by the heparin antithrombin 3 complex through a unique pentasaccharide unit. These are the pentasaccharide units, and they bind to thrombin, which require a minimum of 13. Binding to thrombin requires the involvement of the 13 pentasaccharide units. Low molecular heparin act to inhibit factor 10A and requires that the later, I mean the factor 10A, bind to the antithrombin 3 only. So heparin itself has no action. It is impotent, but actually it brings the antithrombin 3 and factor 10A together to have its effects. The anticoagulant therapy, heparin, the actions of the heparin. It is inactive by itself as an anticoagulant. It requires the presence of the plasma cofactor antithrombin 3. Heparin potentiates the actions of the antithrombin T. Heparin and antithrombin 3 complex neutralizes the action of the factor 2, factor 9, factor 10, factor 11, factor 12 and factor 13. See how many factors the heparin involves. Then it binds to lysine sites on the antithrombin 3. Its friendship with the antithrombin 3 is the main weapon to inactivate the above mentioned factors. Leads to the conformational changes at the arginine reactive center of the antithrombin 3. Now see the sites, the star sites of the antithrombin 3 inhibitors. it can act at factor 10, it can act at prothrombin, it can act at the thrombin, it can act at the protein C and thrombomodulin, it can act at the protein S, then it can act through thrombin, it can act at the platelet, it can act at the fibrinogen, stopping it to convert to fibrin, and also the factor 13 does help in this state. So remember, see the star, and these are the actions of the heparin. Low concentration of heparin increase the activity of the antithrombin 3 considerably, especially against factor 10A and thrombin. These are the most sensitive components of the coagulant cascade, so the rationale for the clinical use of the mini-dose heparin. The inhibitors of the thrombin require that both the antithrombin 3 complex and enzyme bind to the heparin. I have already mentioned that the thrombin binds the antithrombin 3 complex for its activity to be potent. The inhibition of the factor 10A requires that heparin only binds to the antithrombin 3 and not to with the other factor. So there is a strong bondage or love between the antithrombin 3 and heparin, and both desire that they should have a friendship with each other, and no third factor should be come into their friendship bond. Continuing the actions of the heparin, it binds strongly, as I said earlier, to antithrombin 3, leading to the conformational changes in antithrombin 3. And active sites of the anti 3 are exposed, and the active antithrombin 3 inhibits the proteases involved in coagulation. So by activating the antithrombin 3, the proteases are activated and they act on the factors 2, 9, 10, 11, 12 and 13 of the coagulation cascade. And heparin is not consumed but is released from the antithrombin 3 complex, and is once again it is available to react at the end. See its beauty of action, that it itself is not utilized, but it uses the other people. It binds, it plays its role, and then it becomes free and circulates in the circulation freely for having its effects more and more. Heparin binds to saturable sites on the endothelial cells. It is internalized and depolarized by the endothelial cells, and it displaces platelet factor 4 from the endothelial cells, which is a protein that neutralizes heparin. So heparin tries to kill its enemies, which is platelet factor 4 in this case. Action of the heparin is modified by fibrin. So clot bound fibrin binds thrombin and protect it from inactivation by the heparin antithrombin 3. So fibrin and heparin antithrombin 3, they are antagonistic to each other. Who wins? It is a matter of the severity of the disease. Similarly, the platelet, they bind factor 10A and protect it from heparin antithrombin 3 complex. See, platelet have their another maneuver. They bind the factor A so that the heparin is incapable of binding the factor A. So there is a tussle between the two, platelets as well as the heparin. Platelet tries to bind the factor 10A. Similarly, the heparin acts through the binding of the factor 10A. So but ultimately the platelets fail in this tussle or war. Once again, platelet binds factor 10A and protects it from heparin at antithrombin 3 complex. As a result, inhibition and by secreting platelet factor 4. So remember, platelet factor 4, fibrin and platelets, these are the three things products which oppose the heparin, so that it does not defeat them, but ultimately it happens. But it is not the case with the hirudine. Hirudine is an antithrombin 3 independent. Hirudine is also a sort of anticoagulant produced by these salivary glands of the leeches. It stops the conversion of the, it inhibits the thrombin so that fibrinogen is not converted into fibrin. I mean, it is anticoagulant secreted by the salivary glands of the leeches, which are the blood suckers, parasites. So remember hirudine, but its action is through, not through the like heparin, through the antithrombin 3, because heparin requires the help of the, it's solely dependent, antithrombin 3 solely dependent on the antithrombin 3. Heparin, hirudine acts independent of the antithrombin 3 heparin complex. And subendothelial thrombin is protected from heparin antithrombin 3 as well in this case. Heparin contraindications: patients who are hypersensitive, patients who have active bleeding or hemophilia, patients who have thrombocytopenia, purpuric states and severe hypertension, and intracranial hemorrhages, bacterial endocarditis and active tuberculosis, and similarly the patients of the ulcerative colitis who are the patients who have bloody diarrheas, these sort of states in which there is tendency already preponderantly of bleeding, in those states the heparins are never offered. You think 100 times before administering. Similarly, in threatened abortion cases, visceral carcinomas, and during or after surgery on the brain, spinal cord or eye, heparin should never be offered to the patient. And the patients who are undergoing lumbar puncture or regional anesthesia block, they should never be given the heparins. There is history of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. If already offered, told by the patient, then you should never give the heparin to the patients who have told you or given you the history of HIT or heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. The side effects mainly are major bleeding, 5%, thrombocytopenia, 5-15%, and thrombosis, 4.4%, and osteoporosis is rare. Heparin adverse effects continuing. Heparin induced thrombocytopenia already discussed in the heparin in the thrombocytopenia, which can be, I mean, as the drug heparin can cause the immune thrombocytopenia. Two forms: mild reduction in platelet count after about 15 days, and the platelet count usually remains above 100,000. Bleeding risk is minimal. Heparin-induced thrombocytopenia and thrombocytosis simultaneously can happen, especially after 2 weeks after initial therapy with full dose or low dose heparin. And it also be associated with thrombotic complications, including arterial thrombosis with platelet fibrin clots that may cause MI. So that the mechanism of the thrombosis, the side effect of heparin. What happens? There is combination or combo of the platelets and fibrin, which form a clot, and especially in the coronary vessels, which result in the coronary vessels as well as in the brain circulatory vessels, and the patient can present to you with the stroke, and the patient can present with the myocardial infarction after the heparin because of the thrombosis. And it is because of the antiplatelet IgG antibodies in patients with severe form, and may be less common with heparin from poor. Laboratory monitoring, the APTT and TCT. Therapy is routinely monitored by means of the APTT and TCT. A clotting time of 1.2 to 2 times the normal is higher, has to be kept, and the main PTT value equals 50 to 70 seconds. It is therapeutic dose. I mean, when you offer heparin, the APTT has to be kept between the range of 50 to 70. The normal value is about 33. Initially, the APTT should be measured and the infusion rate adjusted every 4 hours. Once a steady state is acquired or achieved, daily monitoring is sufficient instead of 4 hourly. Now, resistance to heparin. Some patients may show a prolongation of the APTT unless very severe high doses of the heparin are to be given. This is because of the presence of a factor which is known as factor 8, which will give rise to severe short control of APTT. They may not be truly resistant to heparin. So resistance to heparin, continuing accelerated clearance of heparin may be the cause, as in the case of massive pulmonary embolism. So heparin itself is cleared because of some reasons or factors, therefore it becomes ineffective or impotent. Similarly, the inherited antithrombin T3 deficiency. Now you see, the antithrombin 3 is the main weapon or main friend of the heparin through which it affects. If there is deficiency, then there may be a resistance. Then acquired antithrombin 3 deficiency may be the happen in hepatic cirrhosis, nephrotic syndrome, disseminated intravascular coagulation, and the large doses of heparin may not prolong the APTT. So it is because of the antithrombin 3 deficiency, which may be inherited and which may also be acquired because of the mentioned diseases like hepatic cirrhosis, nephrotic syndrome, and DIC. Now, the anticoagulation effect of the heparin disappears within hours after discontinuation of the drug, and mild bleeding due to heparin can be controlled without administering of an antagonist. Antagonists are used if bleeding is life-threatening. Management of overcoagulation. Its management depends upon the degree of over anticoagulation, presence or absence of the bleeding, a specific immediate heparin antagonist, protamine sulfate. Its dose is 25 to 50 milligram intravenously, and the side effects are largely allergic in nature. Continuing, pentamine binds to the acidic negatively charged heparin molecules and it neutralizes the heparin. So protamine continuing, it interacts with the platelets also and fibrinogen and other plasma protein to combat the heparin. Use smallest doses possible. Go IV slowly in the infusion form, which should not exceed 50 milligram over 10 minutes, and it can cause flushing, bradycardia, dyspnea, hypotension, and anaphylaxis. Use 1 milligram of protamine sulfate for every 100 units of heparin remaining in the patient. Protamine sulfate is a low molecular weight basic protein, positively charged protein. Heparin's clinical uses: effective for the prevention and treatment of venous thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, mural thrombi after acute myocardial infarction, managing the unstable angina, and prevention of the coronary artery thrombosis. And similarly, it is used to prevent clot formation in extracorporeal circulatory procedures like surgery and hemodialysis, and similarly in the selected cases of the DIC, not in every case of DIC, predominantly or preponderantly the thrombotic variety of the DIC, you can offer the heparin. The treat the fetal growth retardation in pregnant women. In the pregnancy, heparin is the anticoagulation of choice. It does not cross the placenta, has no side effects on the fetus or newborn. Given in the therapeutic doses, about 15,000 units subcutaneously and per 12 hourly to women with prostatic heart valve diseases or venous thromboembolism, is doses in excess of 20,000 units per 24 hours for more than 5 months is questionable due to risk of osteoporosis. So osteoporosis can happen to the patients if the doses are given for prolonged period of time. The low molecular heparins are enoxaparin, deltaparin, and tinzaparin. They contain a lower proportion of the critical pentasaccharide sequence than the parent compound. They increase the action of the antithrombin 3 on the factor 10A, but not its action on the thrombin, unlike the unfractionated heparin. Low molecular weight heparins are not inactivated by the platelet factor 4, and similarly, therefore, their activity extends to factor 10A also bound to plasma membranes, platelet membranes. In clinical doses, no effect on platelet reactivity and PT or APTT. Currently approved for prevention of the deep venous thrombosis and especially after the major surgeries like hip surgery or knee surgery or laparotomies. And also in the unstable angina, non-Q wave myocardial infarction. Low molecular weight heparin does not require routine monitoring of the INR, PT or APTT. One fixed dose is administered subcut and 30 to 40 milligram 12 hourly is a prophylactic dose and must not be administered intramuscularly and is not intended for the IV administration. Use with caution in patient with a history of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. So whenever you offer low molecular heparin to the patients, say MI, stroke, etc., do get a history that whether you got some reaction, especially the low platelet count with the usage of the heparin in the past, the patient might tell you, yeah, then you should not offer the patient the low molecular weight heparin because of its effect, that is HIT or heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. Its side effects can be reversed by the protamine, 1 mg for each milligram of the low molecular weight heparin. Does not require routine monitoring of the INR, PTT or APTT. Thank you very much. Today I have completed DIC and heparin. Please, I suggest to you once again that don't forget to give me the feedbacks so that every time I come up to you with a better presentation, better lecture, and especially some questions of your choice, if you send them, because you have never solved the assignments. This time I haven't sent you any assignment, but read it. I will be taking you a test after a lecture or so. So till next Thursday, it is goodbye from Akhtar Seth Hospital. Read DIC and heparin repeatedly. They are very important topics and they are very amusing also. Therefore, read them thoroughly. I will be asking you the questions in the assignment. Goodbye.